Welcome to the podcast version of Body and Soul, read from the book written by David Doc Robertson. It is available in ebook and paperback on Amazon.com. This bonus introductory episode begins with Chapter 1. Adam Daniels was born biracial April 9, 1940, in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. His mother, Renee, birthed him in her parents' home, where she was born and raised on what is now Orange Street. For Beverly Daniels, having an unwed daughter with a child of questionable heritage was not the brightest of circumstances at that time. "What's the matter with you?" her husband, Peter, asked, after noticing her rare, disappointed expression. She led him to their living room so that Renee couldn't hear. "How are we going to explain that baby? She doesn't have a husband, and it looks like he doesn't have a colored bone in his body." Peter smiled and went to the phonograph. "You wait right there." He turned on the machine and it hummed throughout the room as the tubes warmed up. Then he put on his favorite record, Body and Soul by Coleman Hawkins. He held out his hand, but she refused to go. "Peter, I don't feel like dancing right now." "Woman, get over here," he demanded lightly, and she reluctantly slid into his arms, allowing him to smoothly dance her around on the living room rug. "Beverly, after what we've been through, I am grateful that we have a grown daughter and now a grandchild. As far as I'm concerned, this is special." "He's right," she thought, and held him tighter. With their tragic past, she realized that Adam was truly a blessing in disguise. "Play it again," she said, when the record ended, not wanting the moment to end.
"Look at you."
Chapter 1. A year earlier, 19-year-old Renee was quite mindful of the boundaries between whites and Negroes in the United States. So Adam's white father, Troy Carroll, had to coerce her into the situation that produced an offspring. She worked as the downstairs housekeeper on the Carroll estate, which in 1939 was only a fraction of its plantation size before the Civil War, only 74 years in the past. The stately manor sat on lush green acres in South Baton Rouge, on the southeast section of the city. It at once spanned the countryside like a sea of cotton. Renee's father dropped her off at the home early Monday mornings and would pick her up Thursday evenings after dinner. She was a polite young woman whose parents stressed education. She knew how to conjugate her verbs and avoid double negatives. Her intelligence, however, was not helpful when she applied for the housekeeping job. White folks looked upon educated coloreds with suspicion and saw them as uppity. So when she met with the lady of the house, Martha Carroll, she mixed in an appropriate number of yes'ums and ain'ts to show that she knew her place. She slept in a cabin that was originally built for slaves and had been refurbished a few times over the years, but had no indoor plumbing or electricity. There were four cabins altogether, though Renee's was supposed to be the only one with a new mattress until one of the other workers found out. Master Troy had picked up one after his first secret late-night visit to the cabin. The other workers residing in the cabins were Bessie Jacobs, the cook, and her husband Thaddeus, who took care of the grounds with the help of Grandpa Henry and his wife, who lived in another cabin. Renee loved to read and often went through month-old National Geographic magazines, Betty Crocker cookbooks, or anything else she could get her hands on. In the light of three candles, she chose Langston Hughes' latest publication that night, late in May, and was in the middle of Cora Unashamed when she heard a light tapping on her door. She ignored the first tap, thinking the wind had caused something outside to fall over. On the second knock, Renee set her book down and went to search out the source of the noise. "Mr. Troy, is something wrong? What are you doing out here?" The young master had admired her since she started working on the estate and eyed her brown skin with a heavy sigh of passion. He had just graduated from Baton Rouge High School and was getting through the lazy summer with his future at Louisiana State University on his mind, but romance in his heart. "Renee, you don't have to call me Mister. I just came out here to talk. It's kind of lonely in the house without my dad around." His parents had left earlier in the week for the World's Fair in New York. "Mary Beth is home, isn't she?" "She's in the house with her friends talking about her wedding plans." They stood in the doorway for a moment, listening to the night sounds of crickets, frogs, and other creatures that wait until darkness to move around. During the day, these two often exchange warm glances and smiles, despite the dangerous taboo of their actions. The Advocate, a local newspaper, had written about the handsome 6'2" Troy Carroll with curly golden locks joining the university baseball team, though the Yankees and the Cardinals had expressed interest in him. LSU won out because its father, Preston Carroll, wanted him to focus on business. The father had used his family inheritance to build a giant shipping company and was in the process of establishing an identity in the petroleum market. He wanted to prep his son for his place in that world. In the proper social setting, young debutantes fawned over him. But that night, the dark fruit from the forbidden tree stood in front of him. "May I come inside, Renee?" His smooth southern drawl charmed her, and she knew what was about to happen and how wrong it was, but couldn't help thinking about all the rich white girls wanting what she was about to get. "Don't be stupid," she tried to tell herself, because she also knew the eventual consequences of breaching the whites-only sign in front of her, but reached out and took his hand anyway. It nearly swallowed hers, and she felt the strength in every muscle. "Yes, you may," she answered. He followed her lead inside and accepted her offer of a glass of water from a pitcher on her bedstand. "You're very pretty, Renee." He sipped the water and smiled. "You mean for a colored girl?" she asked for clarification. "Oh, no. I mean for a woman. You're about the prettiest female I know in the entire state of Louisiana." I wish things were different because I'd court you." Those words started to bring back her senses. The noises from outside all seemed to say, "Send him back to the house." She heard it from the frogs, the owls, and the mice that inched their way inside. "You know what, Mr. Troy? I'll bet your sister is looking for you." He ignored her and gently cupped her cheeks in his hands. Then he leaned down to kiss her. That was as far as he had ever gotten with the white girls, sassy enough to allow him to get that close. He found Renee's lips to be the most inviting ever. Their soft fullness gently met his and endeared him to colored women more than before. Everything after the kiss was a first for Troy Carroll. First breasts, first naked body, and the first time a woman had touched him that way. In between their kissing and petting, they tried to bond off and on for nearly 2 hours on her thin 25-year-old mattress, but their innocence blocked success that night. Both were virgins. Neither knew the intimate intricacies of their endeavor. He'd seen animals on the estate copulate, and so it never occurred to him to use his hands. The only thing they knew about sex education was that the devil influenced young people to do it outside of marriage, and that the sperm fertilizes the egg and then the menstruation would stop until after a baby. The next day, Renee went to work in the manor as usual. She wondered if Troy was around, but the young master took the property pickup truck into town. He paid $29 to surprise her with a mattress, but couldn't get it inside her cabin fast enough. The new Spring Air model weighed a little more than he thought, so because of that and its size, he struggled to get it from the back of the pickup. That's when the cook's husband, Thaddeus, ran over and jumped into the truck bed. "Let me help you with that, Mr. Troy," Thaddeus said. He stood the mattress up and slung a rope around it. Then in one move, he had it on his back and leapt to the ground. The action surprised Troy, who felt sure that Thaddeus was at least 40, and yet handled the mattress with no problem. He also handled Troy, who led the way up Renee's steps and inside her cabin. "Right this way, Mr. Jacobs." Troy easily lifted the old mattress so that Thaddeus could set down the new one. Thaddeus laughed to himself and shook his head. "Mr. Troy, I can't wait till your daddy gets home so that I can thank him personally for buying all of us new mattresses. Is ours already in our cabin?" He knew what was really going on and that Preston Carroll would not approve. Troy panicked as Thaddeus looped the rope and waited for a response. His father would immediately know why he bought the mattress and what would happen if he found out about it. His innocence also led him to believe that Thaddeus was truly grateful for something he hadn't yet received. "No, Mr. Jacobs. The salesman told me to come back in an hour for the other two mattresses. I'll go get them after lunch." He laid the linens on the bed and started out of the cabin, thinking about his father and the mattresses. It worried him so much, he could feel his butt clenching. "Mr. Jacobs, my father doesn't know about the mattresses. He's trying to buy oil shares, but I thought you deserved some comfort in your lives. So I would appreciate it if you did not mention this to him." Thaddeus remained quiet until his expression turned into a smile. "Sure enough, Mr. Troy, anything you say, and we all thank you for your generosity. Would you like me to come with you to the mattress store?" He had already taken a seat in the back of the truck because of Jim Crow laws that didn't allow him to sit up front with a white driver. That didn't matter, however, with a brand new mattress coming. Troy felt relieved and smiled. "Yes, sir, I would like that." He got in the truck and started back to town. He spent over $80 that day for the three mattresses, quickly learning for himself about the cost of sex, even with a colored girl. Troy returned to Renee's cabin the next night, but a new mattress did not change the results. Then she left for the weekend, but returned Monday morning. It took two more weeks of trial and error before he gained entrance into the world of an addicting new calling for an 18-year-old. He couldn't wait for nightfall so that he could sleep through the shadows toward his love. Though he began to sap all of Renee's energy, it became difficult to carry out her duties in the house and then entertain Troy at night. She thought his visits would stop when his parents returned, but he would only arrive later. "It's that time of the month," she told him for 2 weeks in June. "It's real heavy this time, probably from doing it so much." "All right," he responded, believing her. The first week in July, however, he came back strong. Though at 18 and in 1939, he knew nothing about trying to please her. Also, at that time in the Jim Crow South, there was no chance of forming a meaningful relationship with Troy. And so the novelty of sex with this rich white darling had worn off. She thought long and hard about a way to end the situation without losing her job. "What will you do, Troy, if you make me pregnant?" He had come by her cabin late on the second Monday in July. Those words shot so much fear into him that he forgot about college. Because of his ignorance, he did not realize that a white man could get a colored girl pregnant. He just didn't think it worked that way with her. And yet, since Renee was his first intimate love, he knew that he could not resist the temptation of being with her. So with that truth in mind, he enlisted into the Navy the next day without telling anyone. He simply disappeared. Unfortunately for Renee, she came up with her hypothetical too late, because Troy had already made her pregnant. Her symptoms began at the end of July, and the baby came 8 months later in the home that Peter Daniels built for his family on his 2 acres in East Baton Rouge Parish. Renee's parents, Peter and Beverly, initially kept her home to hide their shame when she started to show and continuously asked their daughter, "Honey, who's that baby's daddy?" Renee further frustrated them by not answering. The sight of Adam, however, ended the mystery. "It's that Carol boy who disappeared last summer," Peter said to Beverly a month after the baby was born. "She was working there, and in the dark, he found his way to her cabin." He sat up on the side of their bed. "I'm going down there to South Baton Rouge and let his people know what's going on here." The newspapers had written about Troy's disappearance for 2 weeks. The police questioned everybody on the property, including Renee. Then, just before Thanksgiving, the Carroll family received a postcard from San Diego which said he would soon be headed to Hawaii. Renee neither denied or acknowledged the baby's patriarch. She loved her son and took care of him with her parents' help. "You stay away from those folks," Beverly told Peter that night. At 55, Beverly Daniels had experienced much heartache and disappointment. Despite blood testing in 1940, they had no way to prove young Troy's parentage in the South. Such an accusation against the Carrolls could result in a lynching, which scared Beverly. By then, she didn't care who the baby's father was or how light-skinned he was. Adam was the new family member, and he appeared healthy enough to survive the first 5 years of life. She saw those years as the most dangerous for children because she had lost 3 babies before their 5th birthdays and 2 others before 10. The grip took her first 2 before she turned 24. The 3rd succumbed to pneumonia, and strep throat claimed the final 2. Beverly also had to endure the absence of her husband, who fought in World War I, though the U.S. military segregated colored units. The French, however, welcomed the American Negroes and awarded him the French Legion of Honor for his distinctive performance in battle. The honor, however, meant nothing outside of his home back in Louisiana. She had given up on raising a family, but after her 35th birthday, when Renee came in 1920, she prayed hard for the baby's life. At 1 year old, Renee demonstrated her determination to live when she overcame the Spanish flu, which killed 50 million people around the world. This one child's survival tempted Beverly to believe that her suffering had ended, but the thought of Peter going to the Carroll estate frightened her. "I don't want anything to happen to you," she told him in bed. "Well, you know what you have to do to keep me home," he said, and they both started laughing. "Get up here then, Daddy," she told her husband, who was actually 5 years younger than she. He climbed on top of his wife that night, loving her. She could feel his energy and felt confident that he no longer had the urge to seek bodily comfort elsewhere. She twice had to endure his infidelity and defend her marriage during their early days when Peter was still an apprentice woodworker. Peter Daniels finished 8th grade at 12 years old in 1902. He was smart in the classroom, but lacked somewhat in common sense. He had a knack, however, for working with wood, and started by selling small carvings. Carpenter Tom Woodcrest noticed his work in a store and hired him as an apprentice. At 14, he met and married 19-year-old Beverly, who took his word that he was 20, since he had a steady everyday job that paid him $30 a month, and sometimes more because of his talent. Tom Woodcrest inherited the family plantation along with his brother and sister and lived off the cotton production. He started his carpentry business after his father died and hired Peter, whom he allowed to live in one of the many former slave cabins on the property. They specialize in high-end furniture and decorative moldings for homes. Tom loved the work, but more so, he loved to watch Peter work with his hands that seemed blessed. Beverly had dinner ready for him every day when he got home from work, using a wood stove. She had started the vegetable garden and had access to the eggs in the hen house. Nature provided most of the meat they ate, since she knew how to shoot. Rabbits, squirrels, possums, small gators all lived around the cabins, and she occasionally caught a stray chicken that wandered too close from the family's coop. One day, Peter came home and she had dinner ready despite giving birth to their first child the day before. Someone knocked on the door halfway through the meal, and Peter got up to answer it. "Hi, honey," said a female with a fast, high-pitched voice. "I had a good time this morning and wanted to show you how much. I brought what the Woodcrests had left over from they pecan pie this evening." By the time she finished, she had forced her way by Peter and stopped right in front of Beverly. Peter couldn't believe what was happening. He thought for sure that everybody knew he was married, but this girl worked upstairs in the main house, and if she did know, it seemed like it didn't matter. "Beverly, I have no idea what she's talking about." He could feel the fear of the moment crawling up his legs and to his chest, where his heart came to the verge of exploding. It seemed like time had stopped for the three of them. "Who's this?" asked the intruder, whose name was Lucille. She had changed out of her cleaning clothes and put on a dress that was easy to slip off for more romping with Peter. He caught himself noticing the jiggle in her chest and then found his wife looking at him. Beverly felt as much anger as her husband felt fear. "Looking at this man's dealer with big eyes and big lips, I'm Peter's wife." "Well, you's a grown woman. What you doing with a 16-year-old boy? And earlier today, he sure didn't act like he was married." Peter's world seemed about to close. His wife stood 5'9", 2 inches taller than him, and was a muscular 140 pounds. Lucille was a petite gal who did not realize that her life was hanging on a tenuous thread. The baby's cries emerged from a corner in the room, and a second later, Lucille's feet dangled a foot off the floor. Beverly had grabbed a handful of hair, rammed her head on the door, and then lifted her against it. The homewrecker felt the pain of her scalp in Beverly's hands and her feet off the floor. "Don't kill her," Peter yelled. Lucille started to kick, and Beverly banged her head against the door again. "Look, you dirty thieving hag, that's my husband, and that's our baby, Peter Jr., and you ain't got nothing to say about it, you hear me?" "Yes'm, I'm sorry, please let me go." Lucille fell when Beverly dropped her. She quickly got up and ran out the door that Peter had opened. By then, the baby's cries had reached a peak. Beverly took a wet rag from a bucket and used it to clean his bottom while changing the diaper. Then she carried him to the table where Peter had set the pie tin. He thought it was lucky that none spilled when Beverly grabbed Lucille. Pecan pie was his favorite. "Beverly, Listen to me. I don't know what she's talking about. He thought repeating the lie would make it true. Beverly narrowed her eyes on him with a menacing glare. Then she grabbed the large butcher knife on the table and stabbed it through the pie tin deep into the wood with him still in her sight. Afterward, she exposed her breast to feed little Peter while she nibbled. You get my message, Peter. He remained standing since he was a bit anxious about returning to the table. He looked at her and then at the knife. You want the pie for yourself? Beverly's mind screamed, Lord, 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 as she realized the truth. She had a cheater and a liar. You really are 16, aren't you? Well, you see? Never mind. She continued to nurse the baby and carefully ate so as not to disturb the feeding. Peter inched his way to the table while keeping a mindful eye on his wife. I'm going to sit down and finish my dinner, he declared, though it came out more like a request. Even still, he did not rejoin her at the table until she motioned with a nod that he could. Honey? He felt safer when he heard that word. I don't care how old you are. You have a wife, and now you have a son. You have to be a man. Don't he prove that I'm a man? He had the nerve to become defensive. Any fool can make a baby. It takes a man to raise him up right. Peter sat quietly for a moment. Well, I'll help you. She watched him fiddle with his food. Go on and eat. I cooked the supper for you. The baby began to suckle in his sleep. I need time to heal after having your son. At least a couple weeks. Then you can start getting on me as much as before. Peter smiled and laughed a bit. Now that sounds good. But Peter, my message earlier was that this knife will go through your heart if you bring another house wench into our lives. You understand? Showing up, darling. Now let's try that pie. Chapter 2. 3 years later, in 1909, they had added another member of the family, Marilyn Daniels, who was 18 months. Tom Woodcrest helped Peter add a room to their cabin, but it still wasn't enough. Beverly expressed the need for a bigger house with walls that blocked the cold air from coming inside and also provided indoor plumbing. Peter pretended to ignore her pleas. We'll be all right, he repeated. He had secretly been saving his money and bought 2 full acres in the East Baton Rouge Parish near the Colored High School, on which he planned to build a house for his family. Keeping secrets was difficult for him, however, and so early Friday morning, just before the 4th of July celebration, he drove his wife and 2 small children in a small wagon into town. The morning air in Baton Rouge was moist and promised a hot, humid day, with a slight chance of rain that night. It made the trip pleasant as the wagon slowly traveled through the quiet streets and behind the Sears Roebuck office to the Negro entrance. He wanted to get there right when they opened so that he wouldn't have to wait his turn after all the white folks had been served. Peter, why are we here? Beverly asked just before they stepped inside the office. Walking in the presence of strange white folks worried her. It was the second thing that made her anxious because in her 5 years with Peter, she rarely left the plantation. She carried Marilyn in one arm while Peter led his son by the hand. I was going to surprise you, but I'm not good at that. So I thought I'd bring you down here so that you can stop yapping about how much we need a house. His face smiled with excitement as he entered the building. Several sample-size items neatly filled the office. Beverly viewed the ice boxes, wood-burning stoves, furniture, etc. She made sure to point out a sewing machine, and Peter winked at her. In the first half of the 20th century, Sears Roebuck sold houses through their catalog. Prices ranged from $200 to $3,500. The packages included all pre-cut lumber and fittings, plumbing, roofing, heating, etc., and plans. Good morning, Mr. Chesley. It's me, Peter Daniels. I've come to check to see if you heard from the main office about when the materials for my house will arrive. He saw the same catalog that Chesley used to help him find a house just the week before and easily flipped to the page because it had been folded over. See, darling, here it is, your dream come true. Two bedrooms, indoor plumbing with hot water and wiring for when electricity come through. His face beamed with pride. This gonna be our house. Where are we putting it? I bought some land. John Chesley stood and glanced at his assistant, who sat across from him. Then he stepped from behind his desk. Did you say you wanted to buy one of our houses? Peter immediately became alarmed, but tried not to worry his wife. No, Mr. Chesley, it's me, Peter Daniels. I paid you last Thursday for this house right here. Number 147. You paid me? Do you have a receipt? Peter used all of his concentration not to panic. No, sir, I don't have a receipt. You never gave me one. But you shook my hand just before I gave you over $1,000. The assistant, Billy, then stood up. Stop lying, boy. Ain't no sharecropping nigger gonna have $1,000. Beverly became frightened. She heard the amount of money her husband mentioned and could hardly believe it, so she knew a white man wouldn't believe it. But Peter wouldn't lie about something like this. He just knows nothing about business. Chesley took the money and didn't offer a receipt because Peter didn't know enough to ask for one, and no one was going to take a nigger's word over his, not in the 1909 Jim Crow South. Mr. Chesley, I ain't no sharecropper. I'm a carpenter. My name is Peter Daniels, and I work with Tom Woodcrest. He spoke in the calmest voice he could. I'm sorry, boy. I just don't remember you at all. But I gave you $1,000. Peter had lost his patience and realized that he had just put his family in danger. Get out of here, Bev. Billy rushed over and hit Peter just as a white customer entered the front door. That's enough out of you, the assistant yelled. He had received a third of Peter's money. Both men had convinced themselves that the Lord wanted them to have that much money rather than some sharecropping nigger. Now get your black nigger ass out of here before your pickaninnies and their mammy go home alone. Peter quickly got up and stepped toward the man, but barely bumped him the other way. Come on, Peter, she said with authority. Pick up your son. Peter looked at her and then back at the two men, wanting to kill them both for emasculating him and stealing his money. His anger rose because it didn't matter how important he had become or how much money he was earning. His real place in the world hurt his heart and his soul. He heard his wife repeat, "Pick up your son, Peter." "You having trouble with that nigger?" asked the customer who entered and approached the scene. Beverly saw a crazed look on her husband's face. She leaned down and picked up Junior by one arm and gave him to Peter. "I need my husband, Peter." Then she body-checked him toward the door. They got on the wagon, and Peter held the reins a long time before he made the horses move. He barely drove, letting the team steer themselves back home to where they also felt more comfortable. For the first time in his life, he felt himself actually hating. He looked in different directions and saw white faces looking back at him and wondered what they were thinking. Are they also looking for a way to cheat me? The loathing in his heart began to build, and it felt unnatural. Before this, his dealings with whites brought good feelings. Tom Woodcrest was paying him $40 a month. In 1909, that was more than most white men earned. But that didn't matter if even the lowest of white trash could berate him without fear of reprisal. Thank you, Jesus, Beverly said once they reached Woodcrest property. At the outskirts of town, Peter had begun to repeat, "They took our money," but stopped when he heard her words. "Don't thank Jesus for this. Jesus didn't tell them men to take our money." A moment later, he handed Beverly the reins and jumped out of the moving wagon. "Go on home, Beverly." "Peter, get back up in here," she demanded. "Go home," he yelled. His voice convinced her to do what he said. At 19, he had grown a few inches and probably outweighed her as well. So she urged the horses to move faster, leaving him on the side of the road. 31 years later, those times seemed like a blur because that was only the beginning of a horrible 2 weeks that they both tried hard to forget. After Beverly returned home, she waited hours on the front porch as the babies played in front of her. She noticed Tom Woodcrest approaching and tried to smile when he arrived, but tears fell instead. She never had a reason to worry about Peter's safety before because he was always with Woodcrest. "Beverly, what's wrong? Is Peter all right? I knew he was taking you into town to see about the house, but he said he'd be back in time to help me with some work." That statement ended all remnants of rational thought for her as she envisioned his burnt body swinging from a tree somewhere. She started to explain what happened that morning, and all the while figured he went back to confront the men, which is what she told Woodcrest. At the moment, Tom felt angry at himself because he couldn't decide what he liked more, Peter's friendship or his work. He admitted that their common bond was the work, in which several times the apprentice instructed the business owner, especially when it came to the artistic side. Woodcrest taught Peter about the intricacy in building homes from the bottom up. Peter picked up framing easily, but both profited from his trim work on mantels or doors and window casings. Within the upper echelon of South Baton Rouge and other important areas around the capital, the well-to-do all desired to have the best, and word of mouth spread about Tom Woodcrest and his colored apprentice. This is what Tom counted on when he rode into town to confront John Chesley. "Peter! Peter!" he called out during the ride, just in case Peter was sulking someplace off the road. Tom did not return home that day until just before dark. His ride into town ended fruitlessly, as Chesley denied ever seeing Peter. He put his horse away in the barn and then went to his workroom to clean up for the next day and found Peter on the floor, curled up in a ball and badly beaten. "Peter!" He rushed to help him up. "What happened to you? Did John Chesley do this?" Peter's face was marked with bloody, busted lips, a black eye, and a bruised jaw. His chest hurt most from taking kicks in the ribs. Tom helped him to a cot and got a strong hint of what happened. "Peter, you've been drinking. You don't drink. What's the matter with you?" He sat Peter down on the cot and saw tears forming. "White man stole my money, Tom. White man stole my money." In most situations, a color would have been struck down for using such language, but he and Tom had something between them. Peter started crying and explained what happened, and Tom listened, though he heard it before from Beverly. "How'd you get this?" He gently touched the black eye. "You should go home so Beverly can look after you." Peter's face became transfixed with fear. "No, no, no, I can't do that. Beverly would kill me. I went out and got with that Tara Bell. That's what happened to my face. Sharecropper John Bell did this. After I left Beverly, I went looking for trouble. I wanted to die." "Tom, a man don't feel good after being cheated and made a fool of, especially in front of his wife. Anyway, I come upon the sharecropper's old lady, Tara, sitting with her feet in that pond about a mile south of here and sipping hooch from a jar. So I said, that gator's about to have himself a sweet lunch and she pulled her feet out the water just in time. She started going on about how I saved her life and offered me some hooch, which I drank a lot real fast because I figured, what the hell? And then before you know it, I'm on top of her and getting it real good until her husband pulled me off and commenced to wailing on me. I didn't even fight back because I wanted to die, and I told him so. I told him that the white man took my money, so I may as well be dead. Then just like that, he stopped hitting me, but I think he broke my chest. You should go home, Peter. I wanted to die earlier, but I'm sure I changed my mind. Beverly probably knows what I did with the sharecropper's wife already. Colored people know how to spread news. My wife is a big, strong woman, and she's good with a knife. I'll stay here for a while. All right, but next time you let me come with you to buy something big like a house. White men like to cheat colors whenever they can. Peter thought that was a strange thing for Tom to say, but quickly forgot what he heard when Woodcrest promised a raise to $50 a month. A couple days later, Tom knocked on Beverly's door to give her the money he got back from Chesley. He had just contracted to do some ornate work on City Hall in expectations that President Taft might visit early the next year. Tom scheduled a meeting with the deputy mayor and told him to expect the work to be late because of what happened to Peter, who was starting to make a name for himself as a master craftsman. He's all out of sorts over the Sears thing and just can't focus on his work. The mayor himself visited the Sears office with Tom and demanded the money or no municipal body would ever order from Sears again. As a show of dramatics, he went to the telephone on the wall and asked for Chicago. Chicago? Get me the Sears Roebuck headquarters. This is Mayor Miles LaRue of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Mr. Mayor, John Chesley quickly rose from his chair. Of course I'll reimburse the funds. It's been so busy lately, I just plumb forgot the young man, right, Billy? Yes, sir, Mayor, just plumb forgot. Beverly had never seen more than $40 at a time. $1,035 sat in her hand, and she found it difficult to comprehend its value. Oh, my Lord, thank you, Mr. Tom. You can call me Tom, Beverly. And you should let Peter come home. Beverly's smile disappeared. She had heard about what happened between Peter and the Bells. Is he hurt bad? Can he work? He can work, but he misses you and the kids. Maybe in a few days, Mr. Tom. 2 days later, she sent a Woodcrest sharecropper running to the workroom in a panic that would stir the dead in the family cemetery. Mr. Peter! Mr. Peter! The man ran into the workroom as Peter worked on an indoor pillar for the City Hall main lobby. Mr. Peter, your wife says to come running fast. Your junior is sick and she don't think he gonna make it. Peter took off with Tom and the messenger behind. He ran the 100 yards with the wind spirits pushing, and he leapt into the porch as if riding on a magic carpet and called to his son. Peter! Junebug! He burst through the door and saw Beverly draped over her baby and sobbing woefully. Her expression told Peter that he did not arrive in time to say goodbye. She thought that she could save him with turpentine, castor oil, roots, and liniments, but none of it worked against the fast-moving grip that engulfed his tiny body and made it impossible for him to breathe. She first suspected something the day before when he ignored his sister's attempt to play with him. He lay on the floor, sucking his thumb, and then later, he wouldn't eat. In the morning, he complained about his stomach and coughed up blood. The grip tightened and began to attack his organs, shutting them down. His heart fought the hardest and was the last to give out just as his father returned home. He knew from the look of amazement on her face that they had lost this tiny treasure created from their love. How could this happen to us, she wondered. We're good people, but good people suffered all the time, and she knew that. Death knocked on everyone's door, and color didn't matter. Nothing could be done, as whites
lost just as many kinfolks as colored. Beverly started to kiss Junior's face as many times as she could to remember his warmth. 18-month-old Marilyn started to pull her brother's hand to wake him up, and that's when Peter wiped his own tears away. He walked over and cradled his son, gently taking him away from Beverly, who broke out in deep, mournful sobs. Peter first wrapped the body in a cloth and then carried it to the workroom, while Tom stayed a while to comfort his friend's wife. He held on to her a good 5 minutes, creating a scene that would have scandalized all of Baton Rouge, at least the white sections, if anyone had walked in. The depth of the moment brought tears to his eyes as well, before he left for the workshop. There he found Peter working on a log that he sawed in half and had begun to hollow out. Without a word between them, Tom began to hollow out the other half. 8 hours later, he retired for the night, but Peter worked until he completed the impenetrable coffin. He flattened the top and carved the boy's face into it. Then he carved his name inside. The second coat of varnish he made finally dried at dawn. Tom thought it was one of the most beautiful pieces of art he'd ever seen. It's a shame that it's going into the ground, though he never expressed those sentiments to Peter. Peter was 50 when his grandson Adam was born. By then it no longer mattered that he was 5 years younger than Beverly. He had his own business and provided well for her. Tom Woodcrest succumbed to the Spanish flu in 1919, and Peter made his coffin as well. It caught the eye of several mourners who hired him for private jobs, including more coffins. He worked at a leisurely pace and by then had taken on his own apprentice to help him. With the bad memory of dealing with John Chesley and Sears Roebuck, he asked Beverly to describe the house she wanted, and he built it for her with Tom Woodcrest's help in 1914. Renee lived there her entire life. She had been a good girl until her one misstep that began to grow on Peter and Beverly with every passing day. They stopped asking about Adam's father after a month. Peter was satisfied that he figured out the mystery, and Beverly went along with his conclusion. And since the boy was gone, there was no one to confront. "Let me pick up this big old boy," Peter said every day when he got home. Then he headed outside in a secret attempt to put some color in the baby. "You can't have him out there too long," Beverly would go to the door and yell out after 20 minutes. "He'll get sunburned." "All right," Peter would answer. Then he would lower his head and whisper, "See, I need some sun, Grandma, so I can darken up a little bit. That's what you tell your old granny." "I heard that," Beverly answered one day, and they both laughed. She actually did the same thing a few times a day while he was gone to work. Renee noticed how much her parents adored her baby and got used to their help. As Adam got older, he became the family's baby, though they called her to feed him. After a while, she noticed that they began to shower him with as much favor as she used to receive. As the only surviving child, she had grown used to getting anything she wanted from either parent. With the baby around, her mother became more difficult to manipulate, but she still had a big place in her father's heart. Peter bought anything she needed to take care of her son, though he actually built the baby bed, a playpen, and a high chair. Renee loved the Thayer baby buggy he bought until the first interested party approached her in the Woolworths. "Excuse me, girl, but how much longer do you have to go with this child?" Adam was close to a year by then and was just a hint darker than a bale of hay, so some people mistook him as a tan white baby. "What do you mean?" Renee asked, confused by the question. "Don't be silly, girl. Are you or are you not this baby's wet nurse?" "No, I'm not," she answered with a tinge of hostility, nearly forgetting her social standing. "I'm this child's mother." She started to walk away, but a white man grabbed her arm and stopped her. "Look here, darky, you don't talk to a white woman like that. Now you turn yourself around and apologize. His drawl attracted onlookers with its mean and surly tone. Renee stood alone amongst a sea of white faces. She saw one colored man nearby, but realized they were outnumbered. She wished her daddy was there because he never turned his cheek to a white man since the Sears incident, which he told her about several times. That gal should know her place, said a nearby voice. Renee figured she may as well get it over with. So she turned her high-end buggy around and walked back to the woman. I'm sorry, ma'am, for the way I spoke to you. As I said before, I am not a wet nurse. This is my baby. Good day. She turned away with a smile in every part of her face except her eyes, which shot hateful daggers into the woman's soul. She made her way to the exit, followed by the glare of assured white folks. Some good old boy had a time with that nigger bitch, said a scruffy-looking cotton farmer in overalls who laughed with his buddy. Renee stopped at the exit as the laughter died down. Troy Carroll is not old, she said, and left the stunned group of people. The Carroll family was highly respected in Louisiana. In addition to the successful shipping company, Troy's father, Preston, had served in the state legislature. The Woolworth incident and other moments like it made Renee think long and hard about spending her life alone with this child and her parents. As much as she loved Adam, she hated her circumstances more, especially after what Wesley Barker told her. She met Mr. Barker for the second time just after the new year in 1941. She was walking toward the high school with the baby buggy and sinister thoughts racing through her mind. I could say a gator got him, she thought. She looked down over the bridge and saw a sculptured back of at least an 8-foot monster. Further down the gully, she saw a pair of coyotes taking a drink. They could do it. Then she looked into the baby's face. It's not your fault that you hardly have any color, she thought as she approached Texas Street, now Thomas H. Delpit Drive. So here you are. Renee stopped and turned toward the McKinley High School, formerly the Colored High School, from where she graduated 3 years earlier. Wesley Barker stood up from the trim lawn where he'd used a large piece of cardboard on which to sit. Are you talking to me? Yes, I am. See, my classroom is right there. He approached her, smartly dressed in brown slacks with a white shirt and a tan tie to match his brown and tan Argyle sweater vest. He strolled toward her confidently with left hand in pocket. I usually sit inside eating my lunch, and I see a pretty young woman pushing her buggy, so I decided to take a chance and come out and see if she's just watching the child or if she's starting a family. And now, to my surprise, I see that it's one of my favorite students. Renee recognized him as soon as he stood. 3 years earlier, all the girls on campus secretly voted Wesley Barker the most handsome teacher. Good day, Mr. Barker. Good day, Renee. And is it still Miss Daniels? She politely shook his hand and answered, Yes, yes, sir, it is. He held on to her hand because it felt so good in his. You know, Renee, aren't you about 21 right now? Yes, sir, exactly 21. She noticed the strength in his grip. Then, I would like it very much if you felt comfortable enough to call me by my given name, Wesley. That moment sealed the fate of their relationship. Their eyes met in a warm embrace, and she responded, Yes, I do feel comfortable enough, Wesley. It didn't matter that he was 11 years older. They talked until he had to go back inside, and then every day after that for 2 weeks. At the beginning of the third week, she took a chance and explained Adam's origins. He has to know, she thought. Afterward, he said, I think you should start on your way home. She figured she had ended the 2-week courtship. That goodbye was nearly 10 minutes earlier than usual. But she understood his feelings and replied, "All right." Then he added, "I'm going to walk with you a ways so that I can kiss you, if that's all right." It was all right with her, and 5 minutes later their first kiss set off passions that neither had felt before. They continued to see one another, though she kept their visits secret. Peter knew nothing about her walks, and Beverly simply got used to her leaving the same time every day. Sometimes she left with the baby on a Saturday morning to meet Wesley at the school. They either went for a walk together or sat and had a picnic. Then they parted ways and Renee headed home. Whenever she arrived back there, she began to stop and look at the place she called home her entire life. Despite the ornate carpentry by her father, Renee mostly enjoyed the flora that her mother arranged around the front porch. Because of the Baton Rouge climate, Beverly grew orchids right in her front flower bed. To go with them, she grew autumn sage standing tall with Louisiana irises. They all grew behind the shorter woodland phlox, which was a darker shade of purple than the others, creating a sea of violet, yellow, white, and pink behind the neat green grass. Renee stood and appreciated the splendor because she had a feeling that her life would change drastically, and she didn't see the house in her future. 2 weeks after Adam's first birthday, Wesley invited her to his 10-year reunion at Southern University. He gave her a 2-week notice so that she would be able to arrange care for the baby. "I'm taking just you," he said, remembering the stares and cold glances they received around McKinley High School when she visited during the lunch hour. Folks walked by them with judgmental gazes. They knew the baby wasn't white with its ever so slight brown complexion. Wesley felt as if the look singled him out for being the fool. At the reunion picnic, Renee wore a light yellow sundress that accentuated her beauty and youth. Several of Wesley's classmates envied his prize catch, especially since she could carry on an intelligent conversation. "Well, whether we agree or not, the United States will be pulled into the war within the next year. There will be a Second World War, and the colored will be called upon again to serve in a segregated military." Renee and her father had spoken on the topic, in addition to what she read in The Advocate and the NAACP newsletter. Her comment brought a momentary silence to the picnic table on the Southern University campus until Johnny Boudreau spoke up. "Your fiancé sure speaks her mind, Wesley." That term surprised Renee, who wondered what some of them knew that she didn't. She turned to her date, who smiled. "You mean for a woman, Johnny?" asked Cheryl Graham, another classmate, who had just earned her doctorate. A few of the guys moaned, remembering how she carried on in classes about the difficulties women face, and then claimed that the hardships tripled for colored women. "Don't groan," she started. "You men have been leading the way since the red summer of 1919, the bombing and the Black Wall Street massacre in Tulsa, Rosewood, etc. We, as a people, will not gain equality until our men agree that they cannot do it alone." 10 years haven't changed you at all, eh, Cheryl?" Johnny added to fuel the debate. "What makes you so special?" "Maybe that's her problem, that she's special." Gerald Gaines, another alum, spoke up, insinuating that she preferred women. "I'm not going to let your small minds get to me today. As a matter of fact, I love men, especially a big, dark, strong man who can handle my mind as well as he can handle my body." She seductively moistened her lips with her tongue. "Wesley is going to find out what my husband has already discovered, that it's sometimes nice to talk after sex." Everybody broke into a shocked gasp. "Whoa, there she goes. My word. How could she? That's why women should stay home. She needs a man to beat her." Cheryl didn't care what the others said. She knew that one day they would see the light, even if it took another 20 or 30 years. I hope you all know that I'll be teaching African American history here in the fall, she added, to cause more alarm. She loved stirring scandal. It meant that they were all listening, though she thought more women would be on her side, but those present voiced the loudest objection of all. She looked at Renee, who smiled, and then turned to Wesley again. The question of being engaged stuck with her the rest of the day, though she had an idea as to why he put off asking her. Wesley, I've been meaning to ask about what your friend Johnny said about being your fiancé. Ella Fitzgerald sang her hit song on Wesley's radio as he drove his 38 Chevy towards the Daniels home. Well, Renee, I love you first of all. She moved closer to him. I love you too, honey. Her declaration thrilled Wesley, though his next thoughts were difficult to get out. That's very nice to know. I've been trying to find the right way to propose without sounding like a monster. Renee knew his dilemma. Just say what's on your mind. Okay. I want to marry you more than anything, but I hope you know that even in normal circumstances, it would be difficult to raise another man's son. I would do it, though, to be with you. But in this case, I'm sorry, I just can't bring myself to raise a white man's kid. So there it was. In the back of her mind, she knew it was coming. The choice sat in front of her. She had a man, and a prosperous one at that, who would take care of her and the children they had together. Or she could choose the baby she carried 9 months and would have to care for another 17 years. Can I have some time to think about it, please? She leaned on him to establish a physical bond. All right. He didn't give her an amount of time, realizing what he was asking of her. They pulled up in front of the house at dusk and saw that the front door was open. Renee recognized her Uncle Teddy and Auntie Susan's car. They visited often with their daughters and were the only people Beverly felt comfortable enough to allow inside the house with Renee's shame. But her sister's family didn't see Adam as shameful at all and adored the little munchkin. Come on in, Cousin Renee. Susan's 14-year-old daughter, Diane, spoke through the screen door as Renee approached the porch. She waved to Wesley once more as he drove off. Then she joined the others inside the house. Hello, Cousin Diane. Diane opened the door and hugged Renee, who walked into the house, filled with the warmth in which she grew up. Diane's 12-year-old sister, Dorsey, sat in Peter's big chair with Adam in her lap, rocking him back and forth while singing to him. Beverly and her sister Susan sat on the couch talking and laughing. They were very close, especially since Susan lived with her older sister for 10 years after Peter Jr. died. She provided Beverly with much-needed support when the chain of deaths hit the family. Now the grandmother seemed happy, knowing that her and Peter's legacy would continue at least one more generation. A burst of laughter came from the kitchen when Peter and Susan's husband, Theodore, talked about the good old days and the best way to treat a woman. Yeah, boy, sure enough gotta keep a woman in her place, Peter said, just a little louder than he thought. Ain't that the truth, Theodore agreed. What y'all talking about in there? Beverly asked in a feigned cross tone. Nothing, Theodore answered. And the sisters started laughing. Don't say nothing. Ain't none of their business what we talking about. Peter sounded playful. Do you want to hold him, Cousin Renee? Dorsey asked. Adam's mother smiled, happy that the family had so readily accepted her child. No, he's comfortable with you. None of them knew that they had given her a reasonable justification for leaving her Adam behind.
It had to be you. It had to be you. I won wandered around.
You've been listening to the podcast version of Body and Soul, read from the book by David Doc Robertson. It is currently available in ebook and paperback on Amazon.com. This bonus Christmas introductory episode has been brought to you by DavidDoc.com, where you'll find stories for everyone.
And even be glad just to be sad, thinking of you. Some others I've seen might never be me, might never be cross or try to be boss, but they wouldn't do, for nobody else gave me a thrill with all your thoughts. I love you still. It had to be you, wonderful you. It had